President Kennedy's body is following on another plane. President Kennedy's body is following on another plane. President Kennedy's body is following on another plane.
Mrs. John F. Kennedy left the hospital at approximately the same time the coffin carrying the body of her husband left. The coffin went to a private air installation at Dallas's Love Field. It either has left or will leave Dallas Love Field in a matter of minutes. We are told that the gunshot wound, the fatal wound inflicted on the President of the United States, entered at the base of the throat and came out at the base of the neck on the back side.
They said the brain wound in the President's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. The brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, Bob.
Of the President being having his back to the assailant. If this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner, or perhaps one bullet just struck him from the front in the neck and then went up his brain. In any case, the President never regained consciousness.
And the best we can make out now, the President's motorcade had really traveled perhaps a few yards beyond this point, and that the fatal shots that were fired from behind and struck him in the back of the head, and then incongruously some way another bullet struck him in the front of the neck.
One reporter, Frank, who was traveling in the motorcade says it's his guess that the assassin had about a 45-degree angle mm-hmm. on the President, so that it was not head-on or directly from the rear, but on the side.
The Secret Service agents normally walk directly beside the car on either side. We do not see any in this photograph, but usually two or three Secret Service agents will walk on either side of the car so that they are there to spot anyone who looks like a troublemaker.
I know it's been quite a shock to all.
Well, actually, we have gotten little official word from the White House. We got the announcement something like a half an hour ago that the President was dead. There has still been no official words from the doctors who were in attendance. It's known, of course, that the President was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple. I can recap briefly.
First reports said that President Kennedy was shot from an overpass. Our WFAA TV reporter, Mal Couch, saw the gun emerge from the upper story of the warehouse, which has turned out to be the second floor of the Texas Book Depository, which is a familiar sign.
Bob, go ahead.
May report this bulletin that a Secret Service agent and a Dallas policeman were shot and killed here today. They were shot some distance from the area where President Kennedy was assassinated. No other information immediately available from there, except one more point here that This Secret Service Lieutenant Eric Kaminsky has said the assassin's weapon appears to have been a high-powered Army or Japanese rifle of .25 caliber. The entire building where the sniper was located was evacuated. If we could get a picture of our map here and show somewhere of the building, it's a Texas school book depository, which means exactly what it says.
This is the car where the President was. This is what we call our triple underpass in Dallas. This is the grassy area where, and it was originally thought that the shots came from in here, and now it's believed that the shots came from this building here. We have a film.
But the President's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of
us coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the President, I don't know who was hit first, but the President jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker, because he looked, you know, fair. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the President in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you, too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall. I don't know what you call it.
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct. And as you turn, going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. Do you think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president? Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, mound of ground there, the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit, and he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, we seen that. I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Yes, sir, it was awful.
Then it is awful.
We are told that the gunshot wound, the fatal wound inflicted on the President of the United States, entered at the base of the throat and came out at the base of the neck on the back side.
They said that the brain wound in the President's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. The brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, Bob.
Of the president being having his back to the assailant. If this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner. This conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. This conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant.
And that the fatal shots that were fired from behind and struck him in the back of the head. And then incongruously, some way, another bullet struck him in the front of the neck. And then incongruously.
However, a surviving clip of Dr. Perry recorded not long after the press conference.
Arriving at the emergency room, Dr. Perry placed a tube in the president's trachea to assist his breathing. But there was a neck wound anteriorly and a large wound in his head, right posterior area.
Humes probed with his finger, first of all, no point of exit. And then he probed with a small surgical probe, no point of exit.
The doctors were baffled. Then a call came in from the FBI. A, quote, pristine bullet had been found on a stretcher in Dallas. Could it have fallen out of Kennedy's back as doctors tried to save him with cardiac massage?
And the doctor said, well, there's no question about it. That's what happened. That is it.
Relieved, Humes went no further, and over the last 40 years, the integrity of the autopsy has come into question.
There was a third shot. It hit the president in the head, right up here, upper right rear. It opened up a massive enough wound so that blood, brain material, bone fragments came out of the wound.
This part of his head right here is all gone.
This whole section of his head was gone.
There was a massive wound at the back of his head.
This part of his head was blown away and the brains were exposed.
He had a large defect, meaning a hole, in the back of his head.
A quite large defect about here on his skull.
The right back part of the head in this area here had been blasted out.
There was a wound in this area of the head right in this area.
About 7 centimeter opening in the right occipital parietal area.
As I remember, it's like this.
Into the temporal parietal, back into the parietal area.
A big wound, big deficit in his skull and the temporal parietal area.
Back here, right where I'm putting my hand, this part was simply blasted out.
The back or the occipital part, the back of your head. This was gone.
Primary area, which was in the back of the head on the right side.
I could feel it right there. The back, right almost in the middle of the back of the head, just to the side of it.
An exit wound was a large, irregular wound to the front and side, right side of the president's head.
Open area all the way across into the rear of the brain like that.
The wound is approximately in this area.
From the top of the head almost back to the near the base of the skull.
A big gaping hole in the back of the head.
Big gaping hole in the right rear of the head back here.
A massive wound in the right rear.
The back portion of the brain was badly torn up.
A huge gaping hole here in the back. In
the back of his head, above the line. Big hole about the size of a grapefruit.
We are told that the gunshot wound, the fatal wound inflicted on the President of the United States, entered at the base of the throat and came out at the base of the neck on the back side.
They said that the brain wound in the President's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. The brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, Ron.
Of the President being having his back to the assailant. If this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner. This conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. This conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant.
And that the fatal shots that were fired from behind and struck him in the back of the head. And then incongruously, some way, another bullet struck him in the front of the neck. And then incongruously.
However, a surviving clip of Dr. Perry recorded not long after the press conference.
Arriving at the emergency room, Dr. Carrathway placed a tube in the President's trachea to assist his breathing. But there was a neck wound anteriorly and a large wound in his head, right posterior area.
President Kennedy's body is following on another plane. President Kennedy's body is following on another plane. President Kennedy's body is following on another plane.
Oh, it's been quite a shock to all.
Well, actually, we have gotten little official word from the White House. We got the announcement something like a half an hour ago that the President was dead. There has still been no official words from the doctors who were in attendance. It's known, of course, that the President was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple. I can recap briefly.
First reports said that President Kennedy was shot from an overpass. Our WFAA TV reporter, Mal Couch, saw the gun emerge from the upper story of the warehouse, which has turned out to be the second floor of the Texas Book Depository, which is a Bob, familiar sign.
Bob, go ahead.
May report this bulletin that a Secret Service agent and a Dallas policeman were shot and killed here today. They were shot some distance from the area where President Kennedy was assassinated. No other information immediately available from there, except one more point here that this Secret Service Lieutenant Eric Kaminsky has said the assassin's weapon appears to have been a high-powered Army or Japanese rifle of .25 caliber. The entire building where the sniper was located was evacuated. If we could get a picture of our map here and show somewhere of the building, it's a Texas school book depository, which means exactly what it says.
This is the car where the President was. This is what we call our triple underpass in Dallas. This is the grassy area where, and it was originally thought that the shots came from in here, and now it's believed that the shots came from this building here. We have a film.
But the President's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of
us, coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the President, I don't know who was hit first, but the President jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker, because he looked, you know, fair. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the President in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you, too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall. I don't What you call it?
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct, and as you turn, going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. You should think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president, is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, a little mound of ground near the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit, and he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Yes, sir, it was awful.
It is awful.
When asked to specify about the wound, the doctor said the president was shot in the forehead.
President Kennedy, we are now informed, was shot in the right temple. It was a simple matter of a bullet right through the head, said Dr. George Berkeley, the White House medical officer.
We know that Mr. Kennedy was hit in the right temple.
This late bulletin, the president was shot in the right temple. It was a simple matter of a bullet right through the head. This is a quote from Dr. George Berkeley, the White House medical officer.
Governor Connally could very possibly have been shot in the back. With the assassin's bullet still coming from the front of the car. He rode in a small jump seat in the center of the back of the specially built presidential limousine, specially built for such public performances such as this.
Vice President Johnson under heavy guard right now, with assassins obviously still at large, because this apparently is the work of more than one man. A cluster of rifle bullets, husks from bullets, have been found on the fifth floor of the Sexton building from which the assassination attempt and successful assassination attempt began.
The wounds indicated that an automatic weapon was used.
You're listening to KBOX 1480 in Dallas.
The Secret Service tells KBOX News that President Kennedy was apparently shot by a high-powered army or Japanese rifle, about 25 caliber.
First reports said that President Kennedy was shot from an overpass.
You would imagine these quarters became swarmed with investigators, Secret
Service.
There's
a window there.
The window right there where the fatal bullet was fired.
The fatal shots were apparently fired from a fifth-floor window, and that is where the spent shells have been found. Interestingly, the murder weapon itself was found on the sixth floor, which indicated that the assassin ran upstairs in an effort to hide the weapon before leaving the building.
Dallas Crime Laboratory Lieutenant J.C. Day went to the building a short time after the shooting took place, and he walked out with a British 303 rifle. The rifle has a telescopic sight. Now, the rifle was found on the sixth floor of the building near a corner window. Also, police searching that area found three empty 303 cartridge cases, also scraps of chicken, as if a person could have been there for some time.
Now, we are starting to get conflicting reports on weapons. There was one that it was a 303 rifle, and the three spent 303 cartridges were found on the fifth floor of this building, along with some remnants of chicken, indicating that the sniper staked himself out for quite a while before firing the fatal shot today. Now there is another word that a Mauser has been found, a 7.65 Mauser. It's a German army rifle which had a telescopic sight, with one shell left in the chamber. Three spent shells were found nearby. What this means, whether this is the weapon or the other, we do not know. Possibly the Mauser is measured in millimeters and might come close to being a 303, Frank.
Wounds in the governor's chest were clearly visible. The wounds indicated an automatic weapon had been used. Police say this is believed to be a .30 caliber pistol, rather rifle.
Do you know exactly what kind of gun that they found over at the book?
Yes, sir. They have just found the weapon that they believe is the assassination weapon. It is an Argentine 6.5 Mauser that had a four-power scope on it. Also, in this same area, they found a bag of chicken. They found several bottles of soft drink. Yeah. And in other words, the man had been planted there for some time.
This is an Argentine-made bolt-action rifle of World War II vintage. You can see the telescopic sight.
We have
heard that the definite identification has been made of the type of rifle used in the assassination of President Kennedy. It was not a Mauser, as has been reported through most of yesterday and today. Mauser, German-made rifle with the sniper scope sights that was found. Then the German-built Mauser with the sniper scope that was used to kill President Kennedy.
7.65 Mauser, German rifle, familiar to those who served in World War II.
Place. It's a 7.65 Mauser, German-made army rifle, telescopic sight, and one shell left in the chamber. Three spent shells have been found nearby, and apparently they're hooking this as the murder
super
weapon.
Sniper scope, high-powered Mauser rifle.
The Dallas Sheriff's Department said the rifle had been found in a staircase on the fifth floor of a building near the scene of the assassination. It was a 7.65 Mauser.
A German Mauser, I believe.
There's another word that a Mauser has been found.
Mauser.
Oswald worked in the building where the murder weapon, a German-made Mauser rifle, was
still found in the Mauser with which the assassin was apparently armed.
We are told that the gunshot wound, the fatal wound inflicted on the President of the United States, entered at the base of the throat and came out at the base of the neck on the back side.
They said the brain wound in the president's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. The brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, Bob.
Of the president being having his back to the assailant. If this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner, or perhaps one bullet just struck him from the front in the neck and then went up the brain. In any case, the president never regained consciousness.
And the best we can make out now, the president's motorcade had really traveled perhaps a few yards beyond this point, and that the fatal shots that were fired from behind and struck him in the back of the head, and then incongruously some way another bullet struck him in the front of the neck.
One reporter, Frank, who was traveling in the motorcade says it's his guess that the assassin had about a 45-degree angle mm-hmm. on the president, so that it was not head-on or directly from the rear, but on the side.
Well, actually, we have gotten little official word from the White House. We got the announcement something like a half an hour ago that the president was dead. There has still been no official words from the doctors who were in attendance. It's known, of course, that the president was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple.
This is the car where the president was. This is what we call our triple underpass in Dallas. This is the grassy area where, and it was originally thought that the shots came from in here, and now it's believed that the shots came from this building here. We have a film.
But the president's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of us
coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the president, I don't know who was hit first, but the president jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker because he looked, you know, fair. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you, too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall, I don't know what you call it.
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct, and as you turn going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. Do you think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president? Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, mound of ground near the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see the where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit, mm-hmm. and he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, we seen that. I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Oh, yes, sir, it was awful.
Then it is awful.
Oh. Come.
I was professor of thoracic and cardiovascular surgery.
How do you think the single bullet theory was so widely accepted, or accepted by the Warren Commission? How did it get to be so accepted?
I think there were two major problems that they were trying to solve. One was the fact that they only had two bullets when all of the evidence pointed to the fact that three bullets had been fired. So then the question was, where was the third bullet? Then they had another problem in reviewing the frames of the so-called Zapruder film. It seemed that in reviewing these frames, there was too little time between the frame that seemed to indicate when the president was wounded and the frame that seemed to indicate when Governor Connally was wounded. So this led to a lot of speculation that perhaps the one bullet had wounded both of them. And the difficulties of this is the fact that Nellie Connally, who was sitting right there and was not wounded, said this isn't the way it's happened. The president, the first bullet hit the president, and I saw him putting his hands up to his neck, and at that time my husband was not wounded. And then, as she described it, he said he reared up like a wounded animal and turned and grasped the right side of the limousine, and this was a two or three seconds after the president had been hit.
The trend of the clearing, whether it is clearing or not, yes.
Doctor, did you know the president is dead?
We didn't mention the president to Governor Connally. No.
He is out of surgery at the present time, is resting in his room, is that correct?
No. They are now taking care of the compound fracture of the right radius. As soon as that is finished, he will be taken to the recovery room where he will be carefully watched until he has regained all of his vital signs. Now, his vital signs are good now, but we like to observe them for a period of time. This is a routine measure until blood pressure is stable, respirations are satisfactory, and until the governor is fully recovered from the anesthesia. In other words, he's fully conscious, responding rationally to questions. This is being taken care of. The bullet is in the leg. It hasn't been removed. This is a very insignificant factor, though. It will be removed. Left eye, but there's no significant injury to the left eye before he goes to the recovery room. His vital signs are good now, but we like to observe them for a period of time. This is a routine measure until blood pressure is stable, respirations are satisfactory, and until the governor is fully recovered from the anesthesia. In other words, he's fully conscious, responding rationally to questions.
They're asking now if a bullet was found in his leg.
The bullet is in the leg. It hasn't been removed. This is a very insignificant factor, though. It will be removed. Left eye. But there's no significant injury to the left eye before he goes to the recovery room.
It was asked, when will it be removed? They're not asking, will he stay at this hospital?
And yet, Commission Exhibit 399, which according to the Warren Commission, is the missile that broke both the rib and the wrist bone of Governor Connally, is, as I have already explained, essentially pristine.
No, it could not have caused all the wounds, because our experiments have showed beyond any doubt that merely shooting the wrist deformed the bullet drastically. And yet this bullet came out as almost a perfectly normal, pristine bullet.
Dr. Joseph Dolce was the chief consultant in wound ballistics for the U.S. Army, who supervised these tests for the Warren Commission.
And so they gave us the original rifle, the Mannlicher Carcano, plus 100 bullets, 6.5 millimeters. And we went and we shot the cadaver wrist, as I've just mentioned, and in every instance, the front or the tip of the bullet was smashed. It's impossible for a bullet to strike a bone, even at low velocity, and still come with a perfectly normal tip. The tip of this bullet was absolutely not deformed in no instance whatsoever, in no amount. Under no circumstances do I feel that this bullet could hit the wrist and still not be deformed. We proved that by experiments.
The undamaged condition of bullet 399 presented the commission with still another dilemma. While 399 appeared to be completely intact, the bullet which struck Governor Connally left fragments of metal in all three of the governor's wounds.
District Attorney Henry Wade, who convicted Ruby of murder and who would have tried Oswald, there are only a few loopholes in the Warren Commission report. Perhaps the biggest, the single or magic bullet theory.
Some would say that to believe the Warren Commission report, you have to believe this magic bullet theory, the fact that the bullet may have gone through Kennedy and then through Connally, then struck him in his arm and then struck him through the thigh. Do you think that magic bullet theory is a correct one?
I doubt whether that's correct, but I have no way of proving otherwise.
Do you think that magic bullet theory is a correct one? Do you think that magic bullet theory is a correct one?
I doubt whether that's correct, but I have no way of proving otherwise.
Do you think that magic bullet theory is a correct one?
I doubt whether that's correct, but I have no way of proving otherwise. I doubt whether that's correct, but I have no way of proving otherwise.
When the president appeared out in the parking lot, he broke one of the cardinal rules of security. In fact, he broke it two or three times. He went out into the crowd, and of course, Secret Service men find this the most nervous time of any presidential appearance. As long as the Secret Service men can keep the crowd away from the president, they have a good chance of protecting him. But once he moves into a crowd, the Secret Service men are nearly immobilized in protecting him. Another rule is that anyone who approaches the president should have both hands visible and empty. And as you can tell in a crowd, there's no way to determine that. So whenever the president does move out into a crowd for handshaking and backslapping and exchanging pleasantries, he is always at the mercy of the crowd, and the Secret Service is at its least effective position. On September 6, 1901, those two rules were broken, and it ended in tragedy. That was the day that President William McKinley was appearing at the Pan American Exposition in Buffalo, New York, and at a public reception, the crowd moved in around him, and the three Secret Service men who were guarding him had no chance to screen the people approaching him. Because it was a hot day, Secret Service also allowed persons to have handkerchiefs in their hands to wipe their perspiring brows. It just so happened that one of the thousands of handkerchiefs in that large hall covered a revolver in the hand of 28-year-old Leon Czolgosz. He was an unemployed mill worker. He said he was an anarchist. He was also was a man with a long history of mental illness. And as in many important occasions of the world, no one seemed to sense that anything different was going to happen. When McKinley reached out to shake Czolgosz's hand, it looked like a familiar scene, the scene of the President of the United States shaking hands with Fred Nobody. The assassin shattered that picture quickly. He slapped McKinley's hand away and fired two shots point blank. In an instant, McKinley's attacker was driven to the floor. As the president was being helped to a chair, McKinley murmured, "Don't let them hurt him." 7 days later, McKinley was dead. Oddly enough, the assassination attempt was staged in the Temple of Music, quite an ironical note, and there was a quiet Bach sonata being played in the background when the two fatal shots rang out. Now here comes Vice President Johnson, Governor Connally, Senator Ralph Yarborough.
This complete departure from procedure is captured here as the motorcade begins to leave Love Field Airport in Dallas.
Jogging beside the car was an agent in the fog car behind him. Another agent rises from his seat and does hand gestures like this, obviously to order him to cease and desist. The agent stops his tracks three times, not once, not twice, but three times, goes like this. And actually, that's the universal body language for what is going on. Turns out the agent's name was Don Lawton, and he's the agent who's formerly told to cease and desist by shift leader Emery Roberts, who rises in his seat with the hand gestures, and you see Don Lawton going like this. Don Lawton rode on the back of the car on the Chicago trip earlier in 1963, and 4 days before in Tampa. But he's relegated to meaningless Love Field luggage duty during the motorcade, during the assassination. It's ridiculous.
Secret Service agent Clint Hill is also recalled from his position on the opposite side of the limousine.
The talk was that the president could not make this trip. However, it was decided that the security precautions were such that he could make it without any problem. And now, the word that we have is that the president of the United States is dead.
Was killed. The Secret Service agents normally walk directly beside the car on either side. We do not see any in this photograph, but usually two or three Secret Service agents will walk on either side of the car so that they are there to spot anyone who looks like a troublemaker. For firing the shot. It's most unusual, incidentally, that such a thing could happen because of the unusually tight security measures that are ordinarily taken by the Secret Service who guard the president. And normally, any vantage point, a rooftop, and windows which command a parade route are carefully scrutinized and carefully guarded, and men are usually posted on rooftops along a parade route, particularly if there is any reason at all to suppose that there might be someone in the area who would have such ideas as assassination in his mind regarding the president. These precautions, of course, are taken by the Secret Service for all presidents, as they have been for many years.
Interestingly enough, the man, the Secret Service man, who has been assigned to guard and cover Vice President Johnson ever since he was elected to that position, now President Johnson, his Secret Service man, the personal one assigned to him, was ordered a month ago, effective just yesterday afternoon, Friday afternoon, to take a new spot. The new spot was to work on special investigations for the Secret Service. So I think it's somewhat ironic that the man who has been guarding Mr. Lyndon Johnson ever since he achieved or entered the office of the vice presidency, now when he is president, has been relieved of his duty, and this was ordained a month before the assassination that took place yesterday. I see standing by here.
The Secret Service agents normally walk directly beside the car on either side. We do not see any in this photograph, but usually two or three Secret Service agents will walk on either side of the car so that they are there to spot anyone who looks like a troublemaker.
I know it's been quite a shock to all.
Well, actually, we have gotten little official word from the White House. We got the announcement something like a half an hour ago. That the president was dead. There has still been no official words from the doctors who were in attendance. It's known, of course, that the president was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple. I can recap briefly.
First reports said that President Kennedy was shot from an overpass. Our WFAA TV reporter, Mal Couch, saw the gun emerge from the upper story of the warehouse, which has turned out to be the second floor of the Texas Book Depository. which is a familiar sign.
Bob, go ahead.
May report this bulletin that a Secret Service agent and a Dallas policeman were shot and killed here today. They were shot some distance from the area where President Kennedy was assassinated. No other information immediately available from there, except one more point here that Secret Service Lieutenant Eric Kaminsky has said the assassin's weapon appears to have been a high-powered Army or Japanese rifle of .25 caliber. The entire building where the sniper was located was evacuated. If we could get a picture of our map here and show somewhere of the building, it's a Texas school book depository, which means exactly what it says.
This is the car where the president was. This is what we call our triple underpass in Dallas. This is the grassy area where, and it was originally thought that the shots came from in here. And now it's believed that the shots came from this building here. We have a film.
But the president's car was some 50 feet still yet.
In front of
us, coming towards us, and we heard the first shot, and the president, I don't know who was hit first, but the president jumped up in his seat, and I thought it scared him. I thought it was a firecracker, because he looked, you know, fear. And then as the car got directly in front of us, well, a gunshot apparently from behind us hit the president in the side of the temple.
Do you think the first gunshot came from behind you, too?
I think it came from the same location. Apparently back up on the mall, I don't know what you call it.
For the benefit of nomenclature, all of you folks have gone out under the viaduct, and as you turn going under the viaduct on the left-hand side, there's some grass. You should think the shot came from up on top of the viaduct toward the president, is that correct?
Yes, sir. Not on the viaduct itself, but up on top of the hill, mound of ground there, the garden.
How far away would you say that is from where the president was? A couple of 300 yards, something like that?
Well, I have no idea, because I didn't see the where the gunshot come from. We were looking directly at the president when he was hit. Mm-hmm. And he was more or less directly in front of us, and we didn't realize what happened until we seen the side of his head whenever the bullet hit him in the head.
Did you see the blood coming from the president's head?
Yes, sir, we seen that. I seen that. I don't know if my wife did, but I seen that.
Yes, sir, it was awful.
It is awful.
They say at Parkland Hospital that it was really of no use to try to help the president, that he was beyond help when he reached the hospital within 5 minutes of the shooting. They said that the bullet that entered his neck came out the back of his head, and it was quite clear.
How did it happen? Who saw it happen? We have some eyewitness reports. ABC's Bill Lord interviewed some people. First, a Dallas policeman, an eyewitness to the shooting.
Jim Cheney, I understand that you were riding next to the president's car when the assassination took place.
I was riding on the right rear fender.
What happened?
Well, we had proceeded west on Elm Street at approximately 15 to 20 miles an hour. When we heard the first shot, I thought it was a motorcycle backfiring. And I looked back over to my left, and also President Kennedy looked back over his left shoulder. Then the second shot came, I looked back just in time to see the president struck in the face by the second bullet.
President Kennedy, we are now informed, was shot in the right temple.
Well, Bob, from the point where they think the man with the gun might have been seen,
yeah,
to where the president was actually felled, would it have been possible for him to have been struck by a bullet in the right temple?
We know that Mr. Kennedy was hit in the right temple.
It's known, of course, that the president was killed by one shot that struck him in the right temple.
He died of a gunshot wound in the brain. Dr. Berkeley told me it's a simple matter, Tom, of a bullet right through the head.
This hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple.
I was having lunch in the main cafeteria in the hospital, and an emergency page arrived for Dr. Tom Charge, chief of surgery. Knowing that he was presenting a paper out of town, we picked up the page, Dr. Ronald Jones, surgery resident, myself. They informed us that the president had been shot and was being brought to the emergency room. We went there immediately, and he had just been brought in. It was obvious initially that he had a severe lethal wound. Arriving at the emergency room, Dr. Carrico had placed a tube in the president's trachea to assist his breathing. that there was a neck wound anteriorly and a large wound of his head in the right posterior area.
Most of the doctors and nurses who treated the president at Parkland did see a large wound at the rear of the head. Dr. Robert McClelland.
It was in the right back part of the head, very large.
Nurse Audrey Bell.
In all, there was a massive wound at the back of his head.
Dr. Charles Carrico.
There was a large defect about here on his skull.
Dr. Ronald Jones.
Well, my impression was that there was a wound in this area of the head, right in this area.
Dr. Paul Peters.
Right about there is where I thought the hole was. Occipital parietal.
Dr. Kenneth Salyer.
Into the temporal parietal, back into the parietal area, which is the parietal bone right here. And this wound extended into the parietal area.
Dr. Charles Crenshaw.
Angle hole right here on your ear to the back, and this bone that's on the back of your head is called the occiput. Right between these two points was the large exit wound, about 2 3/4 inches, the size of my fist.
Dr. Richard Delaney.
Now, for late details, we go to newsman Tom Whalen at WBAP-TV, Fort Worth.
Hang on. This is Tom Whalen in Fort Worth. WBAP newsman James Darnell in Dallas on the scene of the presidential shooting, the shooting in which President Kennedy and Governor Conley were shot, has an eyewitness interview with a Mrs. Jean Hill. Here is the interview.
What is your name, ma'am?
Jean Hill.
I'm from Dallas.
That's right.
And did you see the shooting, miss?
Yes, sir.
Can you describe what happened?
Yes, sir.
Will you do that now?
They were driving along, and we were the only people in this area on our side, and the shots came from directly across the street from us. And just as the president's car became directly even with us, we took one look at him, and he was sitting there. He and Jackie were looking at a dog that was in the middle of the seat.
No. I would like to close with the Shaggy Dog story. Gene Hill, of course, was here. She watched the assassination. She has become an important and a publicized witness. And Mr. Posner goes after Gene Hill. Quoting Gene Hill from her deposition, to take a picture, President Jackie and they were looking at a little dog between them. He'll elaborated later to say it was a white, fluffy dog. When she discovered there was no dog in the car, she claimed to be confused by the white roses, but they were actually red. She later dropped this dog from her story. The esteemed Dallas FBI worker, Ferris Rookstew, will be seen tonight on CBS ridiculing Miss Hill and her shaggy dog story. As part of the CBS 2-hour special tonight, and so keep that in mind as I take you to Love Field in Dallas as the motorcade is about to begin and as Jackie Kennedy enters the car. Here, under the roses in her left hand, is the little stuffed dog. Actually, it's Lamb Chops. We believe it was given to her by a little girl as she walked along the fence. At Love Field there. We'll have some video in just a moment showing that. Here's her hand, here are the roses. We'll have some video in a moment showing the roses before and after the little white dog. And I thought that Gene Hill ought to at least be vindicated a little here. Okay. Go ahead, run the video now if you want. Actually, she had, not only does she, you see it here, but she shows it to the president in the car. She holds it in her hand between them as he gets the video rolling here. I hope we can see that. And also, there is one clip which shows the car, which shows her shaking hands along the fence, and a little girl gives it to her, passes it to her as they shake hands along the fence. Okay, this will run several times, by the way. Here you'll see her in just a second. She will hold it up in her hand. Right, it shows much better right here, just a second, right here. and lays it in the seat. I was looking for something else when I found this a few weeks ago. And I don't know, we'll decide when there's enough video here of this. There's the little ears. It's lamb chop, we believe. There's one moment in which the president looks, she shows it to the president, he looks down at it. After shaking hands over here.
And about that time, two shots rang out just as he looked up. Just as the president looked up, and these two shots rang out, and he grabbed his chest, and it looked like he was in pain, and he fell over in the seat, and Jackie fell over on him and said, "My God, he's been shot." And after that, more shots rang out, and the car sped away.
Now, what kind of car was that?
What kind of a car was it? The president.
I mean, where did the shots come from?
The shots came from the hill.
From the hill?
Yes. And it was just east of the underpass.
Uh-huh. And,
we were on the south side.
Did you look up there where the shots came from, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Could you see anyone?
I thought I saw this man running, but I looked at the president, and, you know, for a while, and I looked up there, and I thought I saw a man running. And so, right after that, I guess I didn't have any better sense. I started running up there, too.
Uh-huh. And what is your name?
Jean Hill.
G-A-N?
J-E-I-N.
And J-A-N, what's your address, Miss Hill?
9402 Bluff Creek.
9402 Bluff.
This is Mrs. Jean Hill of Dallas. Could you tell us what you saw?
Yes, Mary and I had come down to see the president this morning, and we tried to get a place where we could be away from everyone, and we, I guess, succeeded. As the car came down the hill toward us, he was on our side of the street, and the president and Mrs. Kennedy were in the back seat. He had a little dog between them looking at it, and just as the car came right in line with us, the president looked up, and just as he looked up, two shots rang out, and he grabbed his chest, and this real odd look came over his face, and he pitched forward onto her lap, and she jumped up over him at that and screamed and said, "My God, he's been shot." And there was just an instantaneous, sort of an instant pause, and in the motorcade it momentarily halted, and three or four more shots rang out, and they sped away real quickly. And by that time, I became aware of Mary tugging on my foot, saying, "Get down there, shooting." And it hadn't registered. I'd been so busy looking at the president.
So you were in a very advantageous spot to see the president.
To see the president, but also to get shot.
There were many witnesses to the assassination. Many of them people who had come to town early in the day to find a place to watch the president and the first lady. And I talked to one who saw it happen and took a picture.
Picture, and I took the picture. It so happened my picture, when I took it, was at the same instant that the president was hit, and that does show in my picture.
What does the picture look like?
It shows the president. He slumped. Jackie Kennedy was leaning towards him to see. I guess it all happened so suddenly. I don't think anyone realized, you know, what had happened.
Did you realize what had happened when you heard the shot?
No, I didn't. There was three or four real close together, and it was must have been the first one that shot him, because that's when that was the time I took the picture. And during that time, after I took the picture, and the shots were still being fired, as I decided I better get on the ground.
Did people lie down on the ground?
I just know about myself and the ones right close to me. And, well, really, I just know about myself.
You did lie down?
I did. I was no more than 15 foot from the car and in line of fire, evidently.
First shot, I thought it was a motorcycle backfiring. And I looked back over to my left and This patrolman was so close to the president that following the three shots, his uniform was splattered with blood.
And today, Mr. Stevenson has revealed that he had two conversations with the White House about possible dangers to the president in Dallas, Texas. He talked with Arthur Schlesinger Jr., one of the president's aides, about the incident in Dallas right after it took place. And he said that he, Adlai Stevenson, was told at that time by some members of the Dallas business community that they thought perhaps it was not a good idea for President Kennedy to carry out his plan, which was known then, to visit Dallas on the fateful November 22nd.
Now, the law enforcement agencies in this area are going to do everything within their power to ensure that no untoward accident or incident occurs. We will take immediate action if any suspicious conduct is observed. And we also urge all good citizens to be alert for such conduct. It should be reported to officers immediately. These officers will be stationed at close intervals along the route that the president will travel. Citizens themselves may take action if it becomes obvious that someone is planning to commit an act that is harmful or degrading to the President of the United States.
A interesting development from the home of evangelist Billy Graham, where it was said from that North Carolina location that the evangelist had had a premonition that President Kennedy should not go to Texas, and he says that he tried but failed to contact the president in an effort to persuade him not to go to Texas.
You and I have heard in recent months someone say those Kennedys ought to be shot.
Oswald worked in the building where the murder weapon, a German-made Mauser rifle, was discovered. Oswald has been active in propaganda activities, as Bob Jones from station WWL-TV in New Orleans reports.
This is Lee H. Oswald, October 16th in New Orleans, when he was handling out handbills for the Fair Play for Cuba Committee in front of the International Trademark. New Orleans police know Oswald well. On August 9th, he was arrested for disturbing the peace by creating a scene on the city's main canal street by also distributing these handbills. He resided in an apartment here from May 9th until August 20th, when he slipped out in the middle of the night without having paid his rent. The apartment manager said he was quiet and talked to no one. They found several of these pamphlets lying around the apartment after he had left. This is Bob Jones, WWL-TV in New Orleans.
By strange coincidence, since 1840, beginning with Benjamin Harrison, over our last eight presidents who assumed office on the even years, two decades apart, have died in office. That Mauser German-made rifle with the sniper scope sights that was found on the German-built Mauser with the sniper scope that was used to kill President Kennedy.
7.65 Mauser, German rifle, familiar to those who served in World War II.
Place. It's a 7.65 Mauser, German-made army rifle, telescopic sight, and one shell left in the chamber. Three spent shells have been found nearby, and apparently they're hooking this as the murder
super
weapon.
Sniper scope, high-powered Mauser
rifle. The Dallas
rifle.
Sheriff's Department said the rifle had been found in a staircase on the fifth floor of a building near the scene of the assassination. It was a 7.65 Mauser.
A German Mauser, I believe.
Another word that a Mauser has been found.
Mauser.
Oswald worked in the building where the murder weapon, a German-made Mauser rifle, was
one still found in the Mauser with which the assassin was apparently armed.
From Dallas, we have heard that the definite identification has been made of the type of rifle used in the assassination of President Kennedy. It was not a Mauser, as has been reported through most of yesterday and today, but an Italian Mannlicher Carcanto, manufactured in the Italian town of Carcanto.
They said that the brain wound in the president's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. That the wound was in brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, Bob.
Of the president being, having his back to the assailant. If this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described is true, but this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner. Or perhaps one bullet just struck him from the front in the neck and then went up the brain. In any case, the president never regained consciousness.
And the best we can make out now, the president's motorcade had really traveled perhaps a few yards beyond this point, and that the fatal shots that were fired from behind and struck him in the back of the head, and then incongruously, some way, another bullet struck him in the front of the neck.
One reporter, Frank, who was traveling in the motorcade, says it's his guess that the assassin had about a 45-degree angle mm-hmm. on the president, so that it was not head-on or directly from the rear, but on the side.
His vital signs are good now, but we like to observe them for a period of time. This is a routine measure until blood pressure is stable, respirations are satisfactory, and until the governor is fully recovered from the anesthesia. In other words, he's fully conscious, responding rationally to questions.
They're asking now if a bullet was found in his leg.
The bullet is in the leg. It hasn't been removed. This is a very insignificant factor, though. It will be removed. Left eye. But there's no significant injury to the left eye. Before he goes to the recovery room.
It was asked, when will it be removed? Then I asked him, will he stay at this hospital?
The trend of the clearing, whether it is clearing or not, yes. We didn't mention the president to Governor Connolly. No. No. They are now taking care of the compound fracture of the right radius. As soon as that is finished, he will be taken to the recovery room, where he will be carefully watched until he has regained all of his vital signs. Now, his vital signs are good now, but we like to observe them for a period of time. This is a routine measure until blood pressure is stable, respirations are satisfactory, and until the governor is fully recovered from the anesthesia. In other words, he's fully conscious, responding rationally to questions. This is being taken care of. The bullet is in the leg. It hasn't been removed. This is a very insignificant factor, though. It will be removed. Left eye. But there's no significant injury to the left eye. Before he goes to the recovery room.
I don't know how long the other man is
what
working.
What type of establishment?
Oswald got to the other side of town. Is there anything that can be come up of that? Did he get over by a bus, by a car? He couldn't have walked.
I don't know. We have heard that he was picked up by a Negro in a car.
That is not confirmed.
No, it's not confirmed as far as I know.
Are you looking for the Negro?
We would like to know about him. If it is so, we would certainly like to find him.
Chief Curry, could you detail for us what led you to Oswald?
Mrs. John F. Kennedy left the hospital at approximately the same time the coffin carrying the body of her husband left. The coffin went to a private air installation at Dallas's Love Field. It either has left or will leave Dallas Love Field in a matter of minutes. We are told that the gunshot wound, the fatal wound inflicted on the President of the United States, entered at the base of the throat and came out at the base of the neck on the back side.
Such is the nature of the American system for the presidential succession that Shortly after President Kennedy's death was announced, Vice President Johnson was sworn in an impromptu ceremony in the executive cabin of the presidential plane, the very plane that had carried President Kennedy to Dallas this morning. The new chief executive took the oath of office at 2:39 p.m. Central Time, that's Dallas time, 3:39 p.m. Eastern Time, and for the first time in history, the oath was administered by a woman, U.S. District Judge Sarah T. Hughes. Johnson was sworn in on the Air Force Number 1, the presidential plane, and he then flew on to Washington. He's now en route, airborne to Washington, to take up the duties of chief executive of the United States, duties which cannot wait upon sorrow or tragedy. Mrs. Kennedy and Mrs. Johnson were both present at the swearing-in of President Johnson. So were several congressmen, White House staff members who accompanied the presidential trip. Johnson asked as many of the White House people who were there as possible to crowd into the plane to witness the ceremony. Judge Hughes wept as she administered the traditional presidential oath to President Johnson. And then the plane took off immediately for Washington with Mrs. Johnson, Mrs. Kennedy, and some White House aides aboard. President Kennedy's body is following on another plane. Vice President Johnson.
And now let's go down to Dallas and Dan Rather.
In Dallas, with Lee Oswald, the man accused of assassinating President Kennedy, dead, the big question now is, what kind of man shot Lee Oswald, and why? We have in the studios of our affiliate station, KRLD-TV, here in Dallas, Bill DeMar, who is a nightclub MC, a comedian by profession. Bill worked in the nightclub owned by Jack Ruby. Jack Rubenstein is his real name, known in Dallas circles as Jack Ruby. Bill, how long had you been working at the Carousel Club owned by Jack Rubenstein?
This time about 2 weeks.
You had worked for him before, had you?
3 times before. This is my 4th time here.
The Carousel Club is located right in downtown Dallas. What kind of place is it?
Well, it's a nightclub that has about 5 or 6 exotic dancers and an old combo.
Is it a pretty rough place?
No. There's a lot of people that have said to me when they came up to me after shows or between shows that they liked the place because it was intimate.
What kind of man is Jack Rubenstein?
Well, if you know him, he's a pretty good type guy. He always treated me right, and we always got along real well. I consider him more of a friend than an employer.
Is he an extrovert? Is he a handshaking, back-slapping, rather loud type person?
In a way, yes. Yes. Kind of impulsive. He'd change from one thing to the other on times, do things, you know, out of the clear blue.
You say rather impulsive?
At times.
Could you give us an example of what you would consider some impulsive action?
No, his mind is always working, always going, and he'd be possibly talking to you about one thing, and then all of a sudden he'd take off about on something else.
Is he married?
No, he never has been, to my knowledge. It seems that he mentioned me before. He's never married, doesn't drink, doesn't smoke.
There have been some reports that he came to Dallas from Chicago. Do you know anything about that?
No, I don't.
Does he have a police record of which you're aware?
Not that I know of.
Did it surprise you when you heard this morning that he possibly fired the shots which wound up killing Lee Oswald?
Definitely. I was very shocked and very saddened that Jack would even be involved. But I don't know, the fact that he had closed the club so definitely like he did, putting up a sign saying close and taking the pictures out of the front of the club, and not calling me, notifying me that he had closed. He had somebody else call, but I never got the message.
Now, when was this? He called when to tell you the club was closed?
He didn't call me.
I see.
He had somebody else call me.
When was this?
Friday. When I'd heard about the news of the president, I reluctantly got ready to go to work because I hadn't got the message that he had closed. Mm-hmm. They'd failed to deliver the message to me. And so I got ready to go to work and got down there and saw the sign on the front saying closed. I drove around the other two clubs They were clothed, but they had
Does he own two more clubs in town?
No, the other two burlesque clubs that are near there.
I see. Do you know anything about Jack Rubenstein's political philosophies?
No, he never spoke about anything. When we go for breakfast afterwards or anything, the only thing he talked about was business.
Did you ever hear him say anything about President Kennedy?
Never.
Do you know Lee Oswald? Have you ever seen him?
To my knowledge, if I recollect correctly, I saw him in the audience last week.
Lee Oswald in the audience at the club, at the Carousel Club, which is owned by Jack Rubenstein?
Yes.
That would have been about how many days ago?
8, 9.
Do you remember the specific instance? What happened with Oswald in the club? Was he simply in the audience?
No, I was doing a memory routine, and I use about 20 people in the audience and have them call out an object. And then at random, I call the objects back to them, whoever wants their object called first or saying whatever the case may be. And it seems to me he was one of the people, after seeing his picture in the paper, I remember seeing him in the audience as one of the people that gave me an object.
Did Jack Rubenstein speak with Oswald, to your knowledge?
No, I didn't. I didn't see him. I don't think Jack even knew he was in there.
You don't think Rubenstein knew that Oswald was in the club? It's such a strange coincidence that he would be in the club. Do you think it possible that Rubenstein knew him?
I don't think so. I don't know for sure.
Mm-hmm. Could you possibly be mistaken about Oswald?
Being in the club?
Yes.
Well, I don't know. I remember the face, and I do remember faces.
In your own mind, you're certain it was Oswald?
Yes.
Have you made an effort to see Jack Rubenstein since the shooting this morning?
No, I had thought about going down there now because, like I say, he's more of a friend than an employer, and I did want to see him.
Before all this happened, would you have thought that Rubenstein was the type of man capable of such violence?
No. No. Jack acted a little harshly sometimes, but nothing like this. I wouldn't have thought he did anything like this.
What do you mean he acted harshly sometimes? In dealing with his employees?
When employees and sometimes customers, if they got a little out of hand, why, he was ready to put them out.
Do you know whether he carried a gun on his person as a matter of general course?
Yes. He carried it in a bag when he went back and forth to work.
What kind? Have you seen this pistol?
Yes, I saw it once a little over a year ago, last time I was here.
What kind of pistol was it then?
A little sharp nose. It's a very small little pistol. Mm-hmm. He only carried it when he went back and forth to work, though. I never saw him carry it on him, you know, anything like that. Just in the bag as protection because he was carrying the money.
We have a police photograph that I think we can pick up on camera of the accused man, Jack Rubenstein. Let's see if we can get that picture of Rubenstein on camera. We've been speaking with Bill DeMar, a professional entertainer who has been a master of ceremonies at the Carousel Club in downtown Dallas, a club owned by Jack Rubenstein. Bill, there have been some reports that Rubenstein did own, either now or sometime in the recent past, another club in town. Do you know anything about that?
The Vegas.
The old Vegas club.
Yeah,
is it still in operation?
It was until he closed it because of the president's death.
But so far as you know, he did own that club in addition to the Carousel.
Yes. To my knowledge, he did.
Do you ever recall seeing any unsavory characters, people that you might associate with the underworld around the club?
No. No.
Let's see now if we can get the picture, the police picture of Jack Rubenstein. It's a profile and a head-on shot of the man accused of assassinating, the man who was accused of assassinating President Kennedy. This is Dan Rather in Dallas, Texas, back now to Walter Cronkite in New York.
Well, what kind of man was this now dead Lee Harvey Oswald? Harry Reasoner tells us about the accused assassin in this report recorded just before Oswald's death.
Who is Lee Harvey Oswald, who was shot today? This man who Dallas police say killed John F. Kennedy. We don't know the whole story. We may never know the whole story. But we do know that his big passion in life was politics, leftist politics. One man who debated him in New Orleans says that Oswald spouted communist propaganda like a machine. When the subject changed, Oswald was less sure of himself. He faltered. He groped for words. Physically, a fairly ordinary man, a firm jaw, regular features, straight black hair. He was born in New Orleans in 1939. His father died just before he was born. He was the youngest of three children. The Oswald family moved several times in the next few years, first to Fort Worth, Texas, then to New York, and in 1953 back to New Orleans. They lived first on this block on French Street, a neighborhood of neat little houses on a broad street. An aunt lived nearby. Oswald was enrolled at Beauregard Junior High School, and his records there indicate that he was a poor student, making his best grades in art courses and civics. Just before he graduated from junior high, the family moved to Exchange Place in the old French Quarter of New Orleans. This is a short, run-down street. He and his mother occupied a small apartment over a pool hall. The rest of the street is dotted with bars, a barber shop, a novelty store. At about the same time, Oswald filled out a personal history sheet in school. He said he had two brothers, but he listed no names. He said he was a Lutheran, but he listed no church where he attended. He said he planned to enter the military service or to become a draftsman. He liked reading and outdoor sports, especially football. One question asked if he had any personal friends. He said no. Oswald was only enrolled in Easton High School for about a month when the family moved back to Fort Worth, Texas. But several girls, now married women, who attended junior high school with him, remember him.
He's just very, very quiet and kept to himself. He was in my homeroom, but I don't remember much about him because he wasn't very personable. He didn't seem to get along with everybody, talk a lot.
Benny, he did best in civics and art while he was at Beauregard, and we a lot of times associate an artist with a nonconformist, a person who doesn't dress or act like other people. Did this kind of fit the description of Lee Oswald?
Yes, it did. He was kind of like, well, he was like an oddball. He just didn't mix with other kids in school.
Do any of you ever remember him having any difficulties in class with any of his teachers? Did he seem to get along with all of his teachers, or was he a belligerent person in class? Did he argue with teachers?
No, he more or less kind of wanted to do things for him. Don't you think he was that type of...
I mean, what I remember, I mean, he was a good student and wasn't a troublemaker.
He seemed more like a bookworm.
Yeah. And,
well, he mentioned also in his history record that he liked to read a lot. Did he carry a lot of books? Did you ever notice him carrying a lot of books, more books than other students, for example?
No, just the usual books to take to class.
There have been a couple of people in the city who knew Lee Oswald after he grew up, when he came back to New Orleans, and they said that they almost immediately knew that it was Lee Oswald who had assassinated the president. I realize that at 14 years old, it's probably a little early to form an opinion, but did the Lee Oswald that attended Beauregard Junior High seem to be the type of person who would commit such an act?
No, but like they say, that's the ones you have to watch, the quiet ones, and you don't know what they're going to do. He didn't seem like it then.
I can never remember him just laughing or smiling. He always just sort of smirked like a tight lip.
By all accounts, Oswald was a loner. He himself said he had no close friends. The girls didn't remember anyone who was particularly close to him. But there was one young student, Edward Vogel, who went out of his way to befriend Oswald, and he tells about it.
Would you tell us your first encounter, as you can recall? This has been, what, about eight?
It was about 8 years ago.
8 years ago. Tell us about it.
He came in Beauregard's mid-semester, and... He had a fight with a couple of boys, and that's how I first saw him. And after the next day, someone had punched him in the mouth that Oswald didn't know, I didn't know, and I don't think the boy even knew him. I think these boys that he had a fight with him put this other guy up to punch him in the mouth to get back at him, because Oswald did beat the other boys. And Oswald was laying down on the ground, and I ran up to him, and I think a couple other boys did too, and we brought him back into school and washed his mouth off and put some cold compresses on his mouth.
And this is more or less the start of a friendship between you and Oswald at that time?
Well, that's when we first met, was when this happened.
And what type of boy was he at 15? I understand this was about the age of that year.
Well, he didn't seem to mix too well with the rest of the boys or the girls or anyone there at the school. He didn't seem to have any friends, or he didn't seem to be really interested in anything. He didn't participate in any extracurricular activities. He was just a loner, it seemed like.
I'll tell you, one reason I'm concerned about the age of 15, this reportedly is when Oswald first became interested or came in contact with the Marxist theory. Now, did he, at any time during your relationship with him, did he mention anything about his readings of leftist or Marxist literature?
No, he didn't mention anything at all about any politics or socialism, communism, Marxism, or anything, and I don't believe that's true. I don't believe he had any really basic ideas on Marxism or anything at 15 years old. I think that came later, somewhere along the line, because he never mentioned anything like that to me at all.
Now, in talking earlier, before this interview, you mentioned you had been to his house. Could you tell us a little about his home life?
Well, he, when I knew him, he lived in Exchange Alley. I think it was 126 Exchange Place or Alley. It was a small apartment, and it lived above the pool rooms. And in that area, there's nothing but pool rooms and bar rooms, and it's sort of almost a skid row. It's a very bad neighborhood.
Well, this was before or after his father died?
Oh, his father, from what I understand, died when he was very young, and this was after. I think he had moved to Texas, and after his father died, his mother brought him to Texas. Then he came back here again, and this was his second time in New Orleans.
And he sort of, as I understand it, sort of blamed the world for his problems. Isn't that what you mentioned earlier?
Well, it seemed that way to me after. At the time, I didn't have any basic opinions why he was a little different than most of us. It didn't enter my mind at all. I sort of liked him because he wasn't exactly the general run-of-the-mill that I had known at school. He was a little above them. He seemed to be, at least, even though he came from a poor family, let's say, and he wasn't exactly a ruffian. He just had a little something about him that was just a little different from the average ruffian that I'd known at that school.
Oswald returned to New Orleans in May of this year. In the interim, he had served in the Marine Corps with a bad record. He had also gone to Russia, where he announced that he was going to become a Russian citizen, but he then changed his mind and returned to this country with a Russian wife. He, his wife, and their small child rented an apartment on Magazine Street in New Orleans. And Oswald apparently devoted a good deal of time to the New Orleans chapter of the Fair Play for Cuba Committee, a pro-Castro organization of which he was local chairman. Last August 16th, Oswald and an unidentified young man distributed pamphlets promoting the Fair Play for Cuba Committee on a New Orleans street corner. Not too many people seemed interested. A week before, Oswald got into a fight with three Cuban exiles because of the leaflets and was charged with disturbing the peace. He listed his occupation at the time as mechanic, and he was released after paying a $10 fine. At about this time, Oswald sent his wife and young child to live with his mother in Texas. Then, in the middle of the night, he himself left, leaving unpaid a half month's rent. His movements since then are not known to us until Friday morning, when it is known that he was in the building from which the fatal shots were fired at John F. Kennedy.
Let's go back now to Dallas and to Dan Rather.
We have just returned from seeing a complete motion picture of the moments immediately preceding and the moments of President Kennedy's assassination. The motion picture shows the limousine carrying in the front seat two Secret Service men, in the middle or jump seat, Governor and Mrs. John Connally of Texas, and in the rear seat, President and Mrs. Kennedy, a single Secret Service man standing on the back bumper. The top of the black Lincoln convertible down. Car made a turn, a left turn off of Houston Street onto Elm Street on the fringe of Dallas's downtown area. That turn made directly below the sixth floor window from which the assassin's bullets came. After the left turn was completed, the automobile with only one car in front of it, a Secret Service car immediately in front, the president's car proceeded about 35 yards from the base of the building in which the assassin was. President Kennedy and Governor Connally were seated on the same side of the open car, the side facing the building, Mrs. Kennedy and Mrs. Connally on the side of the car opposite the assassin. President Kennedy is clearly shown to put his right hand up to the side of his face as if to either brush back his hair or perhaps rub his eyebrow. Mrs. Kennedy at that instant is looking away, that is, not looking at the president. At almost that instant, when the president has his hand up to the side of his face, he lurches forward, something in this manner. The first shot had hit him. Mrs. Kennedy appeared not to notice. Governor Connally, in the seat right in front of the president, and by the way, the governor had his suit coat open, his suit was not buttoned, perhaps either heard the shot or somehow he knew that something was wrong, because the picture shows just after that first shot hit the president, the governor turned in something in this manner with his right arm outstretched back toward the president as if to say what's wrong or what happened or say something, and exposed the entire white front shirt of the governor to the full view of the assassin's window. And as the governor was in this position, and President Kennedy behind him was slumped slightly over, a shot clearly hit the front of Governor Connally, and the governor fell back over toward his wife. Mrs. Connally immediately put herself over her husband in a protective position, and as she did so, in the back seat, this time with Mrs. Kennedy's eyes apparently right on her husband, the second shot, the third shot in all, the second shot hit the president's head. His head went forward in a violent motion, pushing it down like this. Mrs. Kennedy was on her feet immediately. The president fell over in this direction. It appeared that his head probably brushed or hit against Mrs. Kennedy's legs. The first lady almost immediately tried to crawl on, and did crawl on to the trunk of the car. Face down, her whole body almost was on that trunk in something of an all fours position. She appeared to be either trying to desperately to get the attention of the Secret Service man on the back bumper, or perhaps she was stretching out toward him to grab him, try to get him in, or perhaps even trying to get herself out of the car. The car was moving all the time. The car never stopped. The Secret Service man on the back bumper leaned way over and put his hands on Mrs. Kennedy's shoulders. She appeared to be in some danger of falling or rolling off that trunk lid, and he pushed her back into the back seat of the car. In the front seat, a Secret Service man with a phone in his hand. And the car speeded up and sped away. It never stopped. The car never paused. That's what the film of the assassination showed. The film was taken by an amateur photographer who had placed himself in an advantageous position. 8mm color film. This is Dan Rather in Dallas.
Also visible in the hall that night, Jack Ruby, a local nightclub owner who often hung around the police station.
I don't think that I ran into him that evening, but he did bring food up for everybody.
Jack Ruby did?
Jack Ruby did, yeah.
Pretext. He has wormed his way into police headquarters, even has observed Oswald at close range.
It remains a total mystery how Ruby gained access to the press briefing at police headquarters.
I went down to the homicide division of the Dallas police, and I guess there were 300 to 400 members of the press with cameras. And then, as I was getting out of the place, somebody ran up to me, and he said, "Henry, I'm Jack Ruby." And I said, "What are you doing in here?" And he said, "I represent the Jewish press."
Basement floor of the Dallas City Hall, and that's a scuffle on the basement floor. It seems to concern photographers.
He has been shot. Oswald has been shot.
Lee Oswald. We're going to.
Oswald has been
we're
shot.
We're going to switch now.
Police. Police are pulling.
We're going to
back,
switch
back.
Now to Bob Huffhacker down in the basement of the courthouse, who is close to the scene. Go ahead, Bob.
Lee Harold Oswald has been shot.
All right, I'm going outside.
Pat, did you see that man fire the shot?
I didn't see him as he fired it. At the moment the shot was fired, I turned around. I did see the smoke from the gun. It was that instant.
Did you see the gun in his hand?
No, I didn't.
This is Sergeant Patrick Dean of the Dallas Police Department who is standing beside us. Pat, you saw the smoke from the gun.
Yes.
And did you see the man?
Yes.
What did he look like to you, Pat?
Well, he was a man dressed in a suit. Would appear as one of the pressmen. However, I was at the top of the ramp, Bob, waiting at the armored car we were supposed to take into the county jail in.
Right.
Now, that's from that location is when I saw the smoke from the gun. As far as identifying him at that time, at that distance, I couldn't.
Right. I know you were.
We happened to be to Oswald.
He was taken back into the jail office. An ambulance was called, and he is at the hospital now.
Where was he wounded?
He had a wound in his lower left abdomen.
Was he an American?
As far as I could tell, it was the only one. I think it was only one shot that was fired.
It appeared, right. There was only one shot. It was right here. But, Pat, you say it was in his lower left abdomen.
Yes, sir.
He was unconscious inside?
Yes, he was.
Does he look like he's dying?
I wouldn't want to say.
Did you hear anything he said? Did he say anything? He touched himself, and did he say anything?
Are you talking about Oswald? Or?
Yeah.
No, he didn't. He was unconscious.
What about the man? Did he run at all, or what happened?
No, he was immediately subdued by the officers at the time he fired the shot.
How many shots?
Just one shot. Now then, thus far, Pat, is the man upstairs in the cell?
As far as I know, he's either in the jail or at Captain Fritz's office. I imagine he would probably be in jail.
Do you know this subject? Do you know him? Have you seen him before?
Yes, I do.
Is he from Dallas?
Yes.
I
couldn't tell you.
I know you can't release the name now, but do you know what kind of business he happens to be in?
Bob, I wouldn't want to say.
Right.
Okay. Did he have to be disarmed or did he give up?
We had to disarm him.
Did he struggle?
As much as he could, yes, but he was...
The struggle completely
He was mumbling. I couldn't hear. I couldn't understand what he did say.
Now,
Did Oswald say anything?
No, Oswald didn't.
What?
No.
Did he have a pistol?
Yes.
Do you know what
pistol.
Kind of pistol he was
no,
carrying?
No, Bob, I never saw the pistol itself. Some other, I think, Officer Graves had got the gun immediately after he fired the shot.
Officer, right. He was in a civilian clothes?
Yes.
Try to get away?
No, he was immediately subdued by the officers.
He wouldn't have had a chance to get
no,
away.
Sir.
How many
what
shots were fired?
Just one.
Did
you
what
see?
Was Oswald wearing? Do you remember when he came out?
I didn't pay too much attention.
But did you know the man? Did you see the man before?
Yes, he did.
Sir,
did you
saw his face?
Yes, sir.
And you knew him?
Yes, sir.
Pat, he is a resident of Dallas, is he not?
Yes, sir. And that's all I'd want to say about the man inside.
When the shot was fired, about 3 feet away from Oswald?
We're questioning Officer Patrick Dean of the Dallas Police Department, who was standing beside me when the shot was fired here in the basement as Lee Harold Oswald was almost ready to go to Dallas County Jail.
I came immediately down the ramp to assist the officers.
Officer, do you know this man personally?
Yes.
In the line of duty or in another way?
Sir, I wouldn't want to say.
But he is known to you as a police officer.
And not as a police officer?
That is, you as a police officer know him. Is that correct?
Yes.
Was he connected in any way with this?
I don't know.
Had you seen him here in the building before the shot was fired?
No, sir.
And could you outline briefly some of the security precautions that were taken immediately before this happened?
Yes, sir. We thoroughly searched the basement. We had searched even the cars up on top of the pipes and things that a person might conceal himself. There was about 15 to 20 men that had searched this place prior to 30 minutes. In fact, searched it twice, about an hour before and then 30 minutes before.
How many officers did you have outside, approximately, would you say?
About 20.
About 20 officers outside the building, and they are armed with riot guns, pistols, and all kinds of
things. Yes, sir. Some few of them are.
And you were then ready?
Did you know this guy before in here?
No, sir.
You haven't?
Today, no, sir.
Not today. Is there anything else that you possibly might tell us about him, Pat? I know that at the present time, you're bound and can't say very much, but you have said that he is from Dallas and that you do know this subject and have seen him before.
Yes, sir, I do know.
Is there anything that you could say about him further than the fact that he is a resident of Dallas, the man who shot Oswald, to shed some more light on?
Well, Bob, that would be all I'd want to say, really.
I'm sure that's the case. Now, at present, what in the way of release is going on inside? How soon do you think we're going to be able to know who this man is?
Well, the information would have to come from Captain Fritz's office.
Now, Captain Fritz came out of this door just a few steps ahead of Oswald. Do you know where he is at present?
No, sir, I don't.
All right. Captain Will Fritz is the master interrogator who was carrying on the interrogation yesterday.
Excuse me. We have a sound-on-film interview now with one of the ambulance drivers. It lasts a minute or so, so let's run that now.
Aubrey, what brought you to Parkland Hospital in the first place?
We picked up a patient on North Houston there, an epileptic, and took him to Parkland. We was waiting for the patient to be signed in at the time everything took place here.
What happened?
Well, first of all, these two men come running in. One of them had a large, what appeared to be a machine gun, and they was hollering for stretchers and cots and everything, and to me it appeared that they was some lunacy or something, and then immediately after that, the Vice President of the United States came in. He was very pale. Some Secret Service men was walking him in at the time.
And did the President come in?
Yes, sir.
And then what did they do with the President?
They took him on back to one of the Trumbull rooms in the emergency room there. Before the President come in, the Governor, they brought him in first.
What happened after this?
Well, then the President come in and me behind him, and after he come in, his wife was behind him, and they took them all of both of them back to the Trumbull room and parked them there.
Can you give us any of the intimate details?
You mean after they brought him in?
Yes.
Well, of course, they run everyone out of the emergency room of the hospital completely on the first floor there, and they told the rider and I to stand by at the rear of our ambulance in case the President or someone had to be removed from the hospital to another hospital. And we stood by there until later on they come out and told us that we would have to help remove the remains into a casket.
Dennis, what happened to the hearse?
As we were standing by there, one of the Secret Service men come up and told us that we would have to help putting the President into the casket and getting him to the airport. And at that time, right after he had told us that, well, Mr. O'Neill came up in our 64 Cadillac hearse, and we unloaded and took the casket into where the President was. And as before we put the President in his casket, the President's wife placed her, took her wedding band. It looked to be like her wedding band off of her finger and put it on the president's and kissed his hand. And then he left and we took him out and put him into the hearse. And one of the Secret Service men, well, about two or three of them got into the hearse and just drove off and left Mr. O'Neill and the rest of us just standing there.
A few minutes ago, Bob Clark interviewed the mayor of the city of Dallas, Mayor Earl Campbell. I think that tape is ready now, so let's take a look at that.
Mr. Mayor, you know the mood of the people of Dallas as well as anyone tonight. What is the reaction of the citizens of this city to the assassination of President Kennedy?
Well, the reaction this evening is one of shock, is one of grief. And it's one of, they just can't believe it. Because with the tremendous outpouring of warmth, enthusiasm that was so manifest throughout the entire course of the parade route today. And then when this thing happened, it was just unbelievable.
Your police force had done a magnificent job since the shooting this morning. Do you feel that the city did everything possible to give the president complete protection during his visit?
There is no question whatsoever in my mind that every possible security precaution was taken. Every off-duty officer was called on to duty. We had several hundred reserves who were on duty. We had several hundred of the sheriff's department. And not only had they taken every precaution possible on their own, but worked in very close collaboration with and under the supervision of the Secret Service. It was just one of those things that couldn't happen, but it did.
Dallas has become something of a storm center of right-wing extremists in the last year or two. Do you think this could have contributed in any way to the assassination of the president?
I don't want to point my finger at anyone in a case like this. Dallas has its right-wing radical group. It has its left-wing radical group, just like other cities. I think that they're much more vocal than they are numerous. And I can't conscientiously ascribe this. This is not a time to point the finger at anything except just the conscience of the nation as a whole.
You don't think the type of incident that occurred here recently when Adlai Stevenson was spat upon after a Dallas speech could have contributed in any way to today's tragedy?
I sincerely do not believe that it did, because while those people were guilty of terribly bad behavior, I don't think that any one of them involved in that had any criminal intent, nor would they be guilty of anything such as this. I can't correlate the two at all.
Mr. Mayor, thank you very much.
Thank you for permitting me to be with you.
A man who can eloquently sum up the feelings of what has occurred in Dallas, Texas today is the Dallas Mayor, Earl Campbell, who gave us this statement earlier tonight. So here is the Mayor of Dallas, Earl Campbell, with a statement.
Tonight, Dallas is shocked and stricken with grief because of the assassination of our president, John F. Kennedy. To no other guest in the history of Dallas has such a spontaneous and enthusiastic welcome been extended, as was the case for our president. Yet, the irrational act of a single man has tragically marred the spirit generated in Dallas today. All possible security precautions were taken by our police force on their own and in collaboration with the Secret Service. It was a thing that could not happen, and yet it did happen. Still, this is not the time to single out for criticism any individual or any group not directly involved in this tragedy. This could only be the act of a deranged mind. And yet, each of us, in prayerful reflection, must search his heart and determine if through intemperate word or intemperate deed, we might have contributed in some fashion to the movement of this mind across the brink of insanity. Mrs. Cavill and I join our city in extending our sympathies to the Kennedy family and to say that our prayers are for them, as they are for our new chief executive and our nation and the world.
Now, over here, Dan, still on Houston Street and not very far from the Rowlands, was Mrs. Carolyn Walther. Mrs. Walther says that she saw two men with a gun in the book depository.
I looked at this building and I saw this man with the gun, and there was another man standing to his right, and I could not see all of this man, and I couldn't see his face. And the other man was holding a short gun. It wasn't as long as a rifle. And he was holding it pointed down, and he was kneeling in the window or sitting. His arms were on the window, and he was holding the gun in a downward position, and he was looking downward.
About what floor would you say these two men were on that you saw in the window?
The first statement that I made, I said the man was on the fourth or the fifth floor, and I still felt the same way. He was just about in a window that was just about even with the top of that tree. I thought the man had light hair or brown and was wearing a white shirt. But I explained to the FBI agents that I wasn't sure about that. That was my impression. I'm thinking about it later that I thought that was the way the man was dressed.
Now, what about this other man who was in the window?
The southern man was wearing a brown suit, and that was all I could see was half of this man's body, from his shoulders to his hips.